Bias and the racial inequality that stems from it wears people down, creates divisions, pushes people to protest. That's the point former NFL quarterback Colin Kaepernick was making when he took a knee during the national anthem, an act of protest that captured national attention and motivated other athletes to action. Joining us to talk about athletes and activism are sports journalist Jemele Hill, retired NBA player and author Etan Thomas, and sociologist Dr. Rashawn Ray. Jemele, I'd like to start with you, if I may. Back in 2019, in a piece that you did for The Atlantic, you wrote this. In its treatment of Kaepernick, the NFL also played out in modern form a scenario all too familiar from American history. The league showed black employees that their livelihood would be destroyed if they questioned white dominance and threatened the systems that have oppressed people of color for centuries. Do you think that has changed in the approximate year since you've written that? Many more people, many more athletes are kneeling now.
We're talking about a league that has used black labor to generate white wealth. I mean, there's a long history of black people being accepted for the entertainment they provide up until the point that they remind those who are paying them or remind those who are giving them whatever platform or employing them in whatever manner, until they remind them that they're actually black people who have to live in America. The moment you start talking about institutional racism and structures that oppress people like you and people who have a lot less than you do, then that's when they don't want to hear from them anymore, and they just kind of want to keep them in this particular box and keep them compartmentalized, because then it makes it easier to dehumanize them.
September 12th was the moment of unity, Kansas City versus Houston, and there was booing pretty clearly, and then cheering you could hear. How did you interpret that moment?
I mean, let's be honest, this is the most gentrified protest that you can possibly imagine. You have players in locked arms. There's not a national anthem being played. The message is unity. This was always about one thing: the fact that the people who booed and were against these protests did not want to hear black people speak to the conditions, the real conditions of what it's like to be black in America. It's always that. So it's not even about the flag. It's not about the military. It's not about any of these other distractions they have always tried to make this issue about. It's about the simple fact that in this country, whenever black people speak about equality and fight for equality, it is met with resistance. And in this case, it is met with just the resistance of people saying, we don't care what you say to us, you still don't matter.
It could have been such an amazing moment, you know, and it could have been all of these great things, especially leading into 9/11. But it just was the opposite. You know, I don't think it was an outlier. I don't think it was something that, you know, isn't directly connected to our nation as a whole. There is this incredible divide, and there are people who are not on the side of equality, you know, not on the side of justice, not on the side of anti-racism.
Rashawn, you tweeted the other day, and I'll just paraphrase it, that this idea that the protests have been made political, they've somehow been wrestled into being a political point of view versus a moral point of view. And you say they should really be moral.
You know, it's highly problematic to see people politicizing this. So we have to be very clear, and it's, of course, most people know this, that right now we are living in a level of political partisanship that we haven't really experienced in modern history. And in this moment, when people are tweeting and making statements like, oh, I don't turn on the NFL or the NBA to watch something political, racial justice is not political. It's a moral issue. It is a civil issue. It is a humane issue. And when we politicize it, it highlights the way that people are able to dismiss it.
Jemele, the role of the WNBA has been quite remarkable, but often women are left out of this conversation. Sort of when we talk about athletes, I think people literally in their minds think male athletes.
These women are used to this fight. They're used to having to fight for respect. They're used to having to fight for equality, because most of them have done it their whole careers. They've been in a situation where their accomplishments and them just simply having access to their sport has been minimized, or they haven't had the same access as men. So they are better equipped to fight this than practically anybody based off what their collective struggle has been.
Etan, Doc Rivers said this thing that was so almost hard to watch. It was so emotional. And he said, you know, we black people love this country and this country does not love us back.
You know, every black person felt him on that, like felt his emotion, understood exactly what he was saying, that we you know, you love this country and you're born here and you have this history here and everything like that, but the country doesn't love you back. You know, and then the first reaction is, oh, well, you make this amount of money. It's not about money. You know what I mean? Because if I go out right now and I'm driving in the street and I get stopped by the police, it doesn't matter what my 401k is. It doesn't matter what my portfolio is, what my degree is. All they see is a black man who is a threat. And at that point, you have to convince the officer to look at you as a human and not to kill you. That's not a situation that white people have to deal with.
Rashawn, do you see the activism of athletes, black athletes specifically, having an impact beyond awareness and beyond kind of elevating the story?
Yeah, I completely do. I mean, so I wrote a piece at the Brookings Institution, like, what should athletes be demanding in this moment? They should actually be demanding that their tax money not be used for these civilian payouts. We should make a shift from taxpayer money to police department insurance policies. The second big thing is they should advocate for the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. The House of Representatives passed this bill led by Congresswoman Bass. It is the most progressive and transformative police reform that we've had probably in American history. And I think when it comes to holding officers accountable, it's not simply about doing implicit bias trainings, which I've done with thousands of officers, or having them put on body-worn cameras. Yeah, that does help for awareness. But we have to change the accountability structure.
To all of you, thank you so much for this conversation. Really appreciate it. Rashawn Ray and Jemele Hill and Etan Thomas. Thank you, guys.